We would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land we are broadcasting from, the Boorong people of the Kulin Nation. We pay our respects to their elders past and present. We would also like to acknowledge all the traditional owners from all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander lands you are listening from. Like us is Anna Yeon, Zione Walker-Nthenda, and me, Noi Harsel, a Japanese Jewish woman, a Korean woman, and a Nigerian Malawian woman chatting about our relationship with Australia and Australia's relationship with us. Hey, everyone.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you going?
Very well and so super excited to meet our next guest and to hear a little bit more about her. Fascinating.
I'm actually really excited to introduce Cameron Bernstein to you guys, to be honest. She was a powerhouse, super interesting, super exciting. She's a Filipina Ashkenazi artist. She's a Yiddishite from the Chicagoland. You'll hear all about her. She says all this in the podcast.
She sounds so smart.
Oh, can I just tell you, she is super smart. She's not hiding any of her smarts for us, and I'm really grateful for this. She began learning Yiddish in her final year at the University of Chicago. She only graduated in 2020. Blow me away. She's been channeling her education into making these really engaging and super accessible content about Yiddish language, culture, and history. She does it on TikTok and Instagram, which is actually how I found her. Don't laugh at me.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's...
I'm impressed.
That I'm on TikTok or that I've...
all of the things.
She's so fun. She's so fun. She's worked professionally in public health, in communications. She's worked at the Yiddish Book Center in Massachusetts. She's a medical student at the University of Brisbane. I'm sorry, studying at the University of Brisbane and Oshner MD programs. I mean, I really cannot wait for you to hear this interview. She's super interesting.
Woohoo. Fantastic.
So let's get into it. Thanks, Cameron Bernstein, for being here. It's really great to have you here. And it's exciting. It's different to have a Yiddish speaker with me. I mean, I feel out of my depth, but I need to ask you the question that I've been asking everyone I've been interviewing for Like Us, because it's something we all share. And I want to know, what do you say to people when they say, where are you from?
Yeah, well, at least in my program, I'm studying at the University of Queensland right now. The first thing I have to say is I'm an American, because there's some Canadians in our program, because I really identify with the Chicagoland Jewish community. And sometimes I have to orient people when I'm here in Australia. And then we go down the next level, and I'm like, I'm a Filipino Ashkenazi Jew. It's really important for me to put all three of those bits in. I'm a Filipino Ashkenazi Jew from the Chicagoland Jewish community. People might hear or might not hear that I'm an American. And it's, pretty rooted in all of those communities.
I love that. Can you just, because it's something I think that's super important that, I mean, my family also has the Chicago Jewish roots. So I totally, we are Skokie people. So,
oh my goodness.
Yes.
So my dad is, yeah.
Okay. So we're probably related somewhere and we can work that out. But I would love you to, explain what that means, why the Chicago part is super important. And then also then, what that means when you're saying I'm a Chicago, I'm Ashkenazi, I'm Filipino. What does that mean for you?
Yeah. Well, the Chicago bit's really important to me because, all of us came from somewhere to Chicago in my family. We're not, indigenous peoples of the Americas. And so when I say I'm from Chicago, like that's a bit of a throw to the grand stories that shaped my family. So my mom's parents came from the Philippines in the 1960s to become doctors in the United States. And they moved around a bit, and then they settled in this really rich Filipino medical community in the west side of Chicago. And then my mom's a product of the 1980s there. And then, then we toss it over to my dad, and his family came over at the turn of the century. Ashkenazi Jews, meaning Eastern European Jews from all over, that had come to Chicago, and their family was in the city. And then with the larger story of I'll call it white flight or just changing urbanization of Chicago, move to the outer ring to Skokie, where we have that connection. And then mom and dad meet in a Chicago medical school, and then they move out to the outer suburbs, and, you know, I'm born and I'm raised in a specific community of both other Jews like me and like other people whose parents are the products of the 1980s America and John Hughes movies. And it's a lot, but like, you know, I feel like I don't necessarily communicate all of that. That's not all communicated when I say I'm a Chicagoan Jew, but who's Filipino and Ashkenazi, but I feel like
it's in there. Yeah. It's in there. And I guess what I'm also sort of trying to work out then, and again, for me, it's implied when I'm thinking about this, the Chicago, the Skokie, the Booby, there's the Yiddish, right? So, you know, and, you know, it's interesting. And again, we'll talk about, I know it's inevitable. We're going to talk about the mixed race thing. Okay. Cause I cannot not.
Yeah.
But let's just go into the Yiddish, because it, like many Jewish families and diasporic Jewish families, Yiddish is thrown around a lot. There's a word here. I mean, actually, let's face it, a lot of Yiddish is thrown around everywhere now in popular culture. But that doesn't mean that we all then do a deep dive and decide to learn the language. So I'm really interested in what about Yiddish spoke to you so much that you go, okay, I will hear your chachkas and I will then take it on and seriously deep dive and learn this language. Why?
Yeah. So I really fell into it. And this is a story that you hear with a lot of Yiddishists, enthusiasts, I suppose, of Yiddish. They fell into the language a bit later in life. Most of us are not, unless we are members of the Hasidic community or unique other types of families. Most of us did not grow up speaking Yiddish. Yiddish kind of fell out of use in my family a couple generations back, really at the turn of the century when my dad's family came here. And my grandmother, my nanny, she remembers a couple of words here and there. We all have the loan words that exist in American English, and we use more of them than the average Joe, the average Joe Schmo. But I didn't consider really speaking Yiddish until my final year of university, when I forgot to register for my statistics courses, and there were no statistics courses open. So I was like, well, I enjoyed learning other languages. Like, why not? The University of Chicago happens to have a Yiddish course. This is a unique opportunity. I like language, and like, it seems like it'd be a fun thing to do. And I think Yiddish language classes are a particularly special sort of community, because we're all really driven and motivated once you start learning Yiddish. Yiddish classes are a specific special place. The teachers are really motivated. They incorporate a lot of cultural context into the language that you're learning. And so not that other languages don't do that, but like there's a specific enthusiasm there.
Do you think people are super enthusiastic about Yiddish because it's almost such an ancient language, or it's such a specific cultural context? Or it's a language that not that many people are at one point, it's changing, I know, have been speaking?
When I started learning Yiddish, it was my final year of university. Kind of what happens when you're in your final year is all of these other things start to shut down. You do your last sports game, you do your last Model UN conference, you start saying goodbye to all of your friends, you start applying for jobs, and everything is kind of winding down. And as things were winding down in my Yiddish course, outside of my Yiddish course, this language was serving as a key to open up an entire world that would kind of only be accessible via the language. And so it gives you a key. It gave me a key into like this whole vibrant world of Eastern European Jewry and literally every place around the whole world where they went when they started migrating places. So it gave me this like window into Buenos Aires, into Mexico City, into the Jewish community of Melbourne. And so as I'm both learning about these people who are using this language as a way to connect with the people from the past and the present, but for the people from the past who are using that language, who would frankly otherwise be forgotten to history. I think we have a lot. We when we hear Yiddish, we think it's a very old language, and that's totally true. that we kind of just like leave it there. Like, all right, yeah, it's like this cute old nostalgic thing. Like, no, I'm not going to think too much further about that. And like, I'll think of it fondly, but I'm just going to think about it in terms of the things I have right now, what I think I know about Yiddish.
Yeah.
And what happens when you start entering that community is you're like, oh my gosh, there's so much more nuance to this world than I could have ever imagined. And if I'm not learning about it with the people around me today, like there's all of these authors and their communities and their friendships that like simply don't exist unless you're using your language skills to learn about them. It's a way to like connect with people.
So what I'm interested in is it sounds like you started it almost like a way of understanding history or personal connection and personal culture. But through that, you were able to see a link to the future, a link to a broader community and a link outside beyond the walls of history, so to speak.
Yeah.
And I'm curious about like, how did that, was it about the preservation of the language or the expansion of the language or a combination of both that you found super attractive in learning Yiddish so deeply?
One of the things people say about Yiddish is that it's constantly dying. We're really preoccupied with that. But at the same time, we've been saying that it's dying for like decades, if not hundreds of years. And so I'm not actually really interested in thinking of what I'm doing as reviving or revitalizing. Like, I'm just more interested in using it. Yeah. And like, Yiddish is a global language. It's a world language. It's a world history. It's not something that I'm just going to pretend. I'm just going to put on my lenses and say that it is something that is relevant. And it's something that I'm going to bridge into the contemporary world with other people. And so, like, I just use it.
I think that's what you do super well. And that's what I love. And I think that's what so many people are loving about what you're doing is that you've got a way of, you know, being Yiddish and doing Yiddish that is more than your language, your learning of the language. And I think that's evidenced by the way you bring it on TikTok and through your social media presence about the living language and the use of it in the everyday. So I'd love to hear more about how that evolved for you and why you think it has such resonance with people. I mean, because it must have, I can only but imagine as having resonance with people who aren't Jewish and aren't speaking Yiddish, you know, all the things, right?
Yeah. So it started for me, I graduated into the pandemic. I had nothing to do other than work 40 hours a week for my first full-time job, and I couldn't go out and I couldn't see my friends. But I was saying my senior year of college, my senior year of university, sorry, you guys use college differently here. my final year, Yiddish gave me an opening into a world, and it was as the world shut down, there was still a whole wide world for me to explore and me to do my gap year travels on, quote unquote, into the archives, into a whole new music scene, into watching 1980s Israeli Yiddish disco musicals. I'm like, oh my God, this stuff exists. And so, you know, it was a way to keep. So I started making TikToks in order to, number one, not lose my Yiddish skills by using Yiddish, however good or not so good it was at the time when I started using it. I was like, well, it's if you don't use it, you will lose it. Mm-hmm. And like, I'm just curious and continuing to explore this world. And so if I force myself to publish something out on the internet, 30 seconds to a minute long, I'll be pushing myself to go a little bit deeper. And most people don't get the opportunity to learn Yiddish in the home or at a university. And so, you know, maybe this is a way that I can bring some of what I love so much to other people and give them the key to start opening a whole new world for themselves. So I was like, let's just do it. Let's just start making these things. I'm not a professor. I'm working in public health, like, but I've got time and like, I can sing a little bit and like, apparently videos are fun for me to make. So let's just do this. Let's just have this be a practice.
And people are loving it. Like, you have such a following and people, I mean, I love it. People are loving it. People are loving it even if they have no intention of learning. So in itself, the mere act of doing this is an act of peace, an act of, you know, cultural awareness, an act of teaching. And I mean, it's beautiful. You must be getting some incredible responses from people.
Yeah. I mean, there's definitely the wonderful response from other people of the Jewish community. And I think I love from how diverse of a collection of the Jewish community will find resonance in what I do. So both the people who just have the cultural connection to their Jewishness, but religion's not really a part of their life, but they are Ashkenazi Jews and Yiddish is a part of their personal family's history, to Jews who are, I don't love saying a religious hierarchy exists, but people who they consider themselves more religious than I do. But all of us, even some members of the Hasidic community who have found my work, even though we know that we come from very different corners of the Jewish world, we share this connection to Yiddish. And, you know, via Yiddish being that thing, I'm able to introduce a lot of other parts of my Jewish identity, my multiracial, my multicultural identity. I'm kind of able to pull those in to their understanding of what's possible in the Jewish world because I have this Yiddish thing in common with them. So that's really cool. But then outside of the Yiddish Jewish world, I love connecting with people about they have their own minority languages that they grew up speaking or not grew up speaking or want to find connection to or want to preserve, like some man in northern Spain who like just messaged me from the Basque region the other day. He was like, thank you for what you do. Like my language community, we have very similar concerns. And so I love seeing you just go out and using it. So I love moments like that too.
That's amazing. And I love what you're bringing up in terms of expressing diversity within communities. And if you don't mind, I'd love to hear your thoughts and what do you say about, I mean, we started by talking about what do you say when people say, where do you come from? Mm. But I mean, so for you speaking Yiddish in this community and being mixed race, how does that play out for you?
Sometimes when I make my Yiddish content, I'm like, you know, like this is what I'm here to do. And when people, they'll throw out a lot of what feel to me as non sequiturs. I'm like, okay, like here's a woman who wrote about her love life in Yiddish at the turn of the century. And that's what I made my video about. And then people are like, so are you Asian? And then if you're Asian, how are you Jewish? And I'm like, oh my goodness. I put it in my bio online because it's a frequently asked question and kind of not relevant to what I'm doing right now. But to them, it is relevant because I'm just another face who has come up on their algorithm that they're scrolling through. And so if I'm using my more, my less judgmental reading of their comment, which is very hard to do given the number of those mm-hmm. that I get, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. you know, it's not relevant to me when I made that video, but it's relevant to them because you read someone's face and you can observe some things about them. And I am an Asian person, and I am a Jewish person. Mm-hmm. My last name is Bernstein. And so they put all of these clues together and there's a dissonance for them. There's no dissonance for me. But it can be kind of annoying or shocking or whatnot sometimes. So that's hard online. I'm so happy to like talk about being a multiracial person when I'm in Yiddish spaces in person, face to face, because like, we're willing to have a conversation about it. And like, I can both offer parts of myself and the person next to me can offer parts of themselves. And we have a conversation about what are both of our identities equally complex mean to each other. But it's a lot harder being a person who makes this content online. And I'll just say more annoying to receive those.
Well, also because the person who's making the comment to you, and I can be super blunt about it, it's much more cowardly. So it's so easy to you know, press send and disappear as opposed to face and face, you're offering an engagement. There's a curiosity. Mm. One assumes a real curiosity there. I mean, I'm also interested in, I know that you have a natural interest in language and obviously a real skill in languages. It's perfectly clear. And I wondered, through the study of Yiddish, was there something in that that also solidified or helped with your own, or, you know, I don't know, was there something in there for your own identity or your own Jewish identity that was grounding?
As Yiddish is a language that is diasporic, that comes from a people that is diasporic, that had people mostly in Central and Eastern Europe who then went to all of these different corners of the world, but were still in contact with each other. By learning that language and observing how these people were creating a sense of identity, creating a sense of story, that kind of gave me the capacity to apply the same lens and lessons of what it means to be a diasporic person and carry that identity with me. I think it made it a lot easier for me to understand my own Asian American identity mm-hmm. as well. I think it's really hard to have an Asian American identity, specifically when you're biracial, because so much of it is like, I mean, so much of our identity is number one, how we practice it, but two, I mean, it's shaped by how others perceive us.
Yeah.
And so when other Asian Americans don't necessarily perceive you as Asian, or other members of the Jewish community see you as like slightly Jewish, but like in an off-brand sort of way,
yes.
That puts you in a weird spot. But via my understanding of Yiddish and Yiddish history and how to explore that and its relationship with diaspora and community, it really helps me understand my mom's side of the family in our own journey, and you know what happened when my grandparents came to the United States and how they formed their own Illinois Filipino Medical Society organization in the Chicago suburbs, and the barbecues that my mom used to have with the other members of the Filipino American community there, and the balls that they would put on, and the mutual aid that they would send back to the Philippines, and that's so parallel
yes.
to these Landsmannschaft organizations that existed in the Jewish world. And like, I feel my story and understand my identity as a Filipino American through that practice of identity, not only with what I do right now with my mom mm-hmm. and like the holidays and the family, et cetera. And that's great and wonderful. But also like in understanding this more history, yes. like how to situate my family's story and all of that.
I love that. I really feel that at the end. I mean, it's those hybrid identities. I mean, hybrid identities only for others. But yeah, because, we are skating between the landscapes of others, you know, that others have identified for us, have already defined. And I think in small communities like Jewish communities, which can be very narrow-minded and more, I don't know how you've experienced it in Brisbane, I can't imagine.
But it's interesting here.
I don't even want to be specific, but yeah.
I appreciate the virtual community. I'll also just like, I just want to quickly shout out, regardless of this is in the episode or not, you know, it's really helpful to me that there are some other members of the Yiddishist community who also have biracial identities, and they're older than me. It's nice to just see them out there doing their own thing. And I also want to throw out that, like, while some people clock me online, not everyone does. And there are members of my Yiddishist community or Jewish community who, like, have it so much more intrusively worse and the entitlement that people feel to like understanding exactly how are they Jewish, that those lives. And so, I don't know, I feel very lucky, happy to be here.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Hey, everyone. So I hope you really enjoyed hearing from Cameron.
Really, I know it's layered, nuanced, yeah, it's everything.
I'm letting that digest a little.
Totally. And can I also say, that was also a fascinating insight into you, Noi, because of the connection that you both had in terms of having Ashkenazi Jewish heritage, but also the Chicago Jewish community, you know, and the term Skokie, which I'd never heard
of
before.
Suburb,
right?
It's a suburb.
Okay. So there was so much education for me in this particular piece. And I love her manner. I love her introduction. It felt very inviting, like she was pulling people into her world to understand her world. And I was so in it. I can so understand how she's super popular on TikTok and Instagram because that's her manner. It's very, very inviting. I loved it.
She's really amazing, very generous, very kind. And it's interesting. Everyone that, you know, I've been speaking to is biracial. I mean, and it's interesting that she happens to be Jewish and biracial. So obviously I felt a strong sisterhood to her.
Mm-mm.
And with that, you know, there was a strong connection. It was a coincidence that she was also from Skokie, just outside of Chicago, as my family also is.
Amazing.
And that whole notion of the location and identity and how that holds resonance and history in terms of who you are and how you categorize or, you know, commodify, I suppose, who you are when you say
where you're from.
That's
right.
Right. And how that holds. I mean, I guess for me, I thought what was really interesting was how Yiddish for her, I was sort of expecting, yes, that's unlocked a part of my Jewish identity and blah, blah, blah. But what it really did for her was also unlock part of her Filipina identity.
Absolutely. I loved that. I really, really loved that connection point because I didn't expect that, right? I felt like, okay, there's the Filipino identity and maybe she's clear about that and she's exploring this. But in opening up this world into this diaspora, it opened up a context for her around, okay, this is sort of what that experience is as a second, third generation person in another part of the world trying to establish yourself. I mean, it was interesting that, you know, her mother came from this Filipino medical community and established themselves in Chicago and therefore met her father at medical school too, right?
Yes.
As two immigrants, I suppose.
It was just great, right? That they had all of these various connections and almost this coincidence that they meet here. And it was it was this third element, the unlocking through a random study that their daughter finds
in her final year at university.
Right, because she missed a subject.
Yeah.
You know?
Like just another elective.
Exactly.
All right, then.
Exactly. And then that's the way that she finds her own narrative, her way of understanding her sense of identity.
I just wanted to pick up on what Zione said about how through this interview, we actually got to know more about you, Noi.
I've been trying to make that not happen.
I know, but I can't kind of move on from that because I think in our friendship, like I've kind of maybe subconsciously thought more of you as a person that had, yes, Jewish, but also the Japanese part of you because it's the part that I can kind of maybe more intimately relate and, you know, share experiences about our mothers being Asian mothers.
Yeah.
Da, da, da.
But
listening to this interview made me learn. And it, yes, absolutely. This big educational sort of experience about this sophisticated old civilization that you're also part of that I'm just starting to learn. And you have a literacy, you have a belonging in this whole other world that somehow, not that you weren't before, but somehow you seem a lot more sophisticated to me now.
If only you knew you could turn that on sooner.
There's a whole richness of another thing and there's it's everything that you two talked about sounded so smart, but I only understood a fraction of it, you know? I'm like, I don't know a thing about Yiddish.
You know, it's so funny, Anna, you say that because there's an entire world who would see me so the opposite. I mean, it's not smart. What I mean is see me as a Jewish person, not as an Asian person, and would be super surprised to hear
about
that.
So I'm curious about why you think that is. Is it dependent on how they've accessed you?
Possibly.
So if people have known you through your Jewish side, that's what becomes more live for them.
Possibly. Or again, it's about the facing. So it's the presentation, you know, it's the context. It's also how I possibly look. And we talk about this a little bit as well with Cameron about how you face the presentation, the packaging, I suppose, if you like. The packaging, the wrapping paper that you're presented in sometimes is complicated for the people who are viewing it.
Yes.
And so Cameron, who is, I suppose, arguably, and excuse me for the way this comes across insane, but is beautifully, you know, is beautifully mixed race. And so when she sings or speaks in Yiddish, the packaging is not as one expects. She doesn't look like your stereotypically quote-unquote Ashkenazi Jew.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so that could be quite confrontational for some people who are viewing or listening to her. And she has had to deal with that on a social platform.
Yes.
So it's very different, contextually very different.
Absolutely. I really liked how she talked about it. She just owned it, right? Like she recognized that while it doesn't present that way for her in her lived reality, yeah. for other people, there's some kind of dissonance for them. Yeah. And so she makes it a point to sometimes just articulate that for them, just make it easier so that, okay, let's get on and deal with the business yeah. because this is how you can position me and understand the packaging and the context and the nuance. And again, I thought that was a graceful way to approach yes. that, right?
I have to say, she's super, I mean, she's a lot more mature and graceful yeah. than I was at her age.
I mean, I know, when you said she graduated at 2020, I'm sort of doing the math and thinking, okay,
what?
Yeah, very graceful, very, yeah. very mature. She talked about identity as practice,
yeah,
which I thought was really, really interesting. And I could understand why she was talking about it in that context because of how she's come to practice and understand yeah. and learn Yiddish,
yeah.
that's identity, but that's also her practicing her identity. Yeah. I really love that. I'd never really sort of put the two things quite so articulately together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought was also beautiful was how she makes the statement that identity is also shaped, though, by how we are perceived.
Yes.
And I
yes.
think that also signifies the generosity, but it also signifies the danger
yes.
around us.
Yes.
And how we have to be really careful about how we project onto others. And, you know, so we can be as generous as we want to, you know, by saying, I can see you and I relate to you on this level. And I also, as Anna very beautifully said, and I now respect you in another way because I'm seeing this.
Yes. Mm.
But the flip side can be, you are no longer fitting the vision that I had of you as this type of person.
Gosh. Yeah.
You know,
so
and yeah. becomes hard.
Yeah. So that could be the flip side too. That's right. But how about the person who's the recipient of the projection?
Yeah.
It's very difficult. And I don't know where the line is. How do you then divorce yourself from other people's projections and perceptions?
That's hard.
Right? Because you're constantly receiving it all the time from everywhere, right? And like she's getting it on social media yes. and trolls and this, yes. that, and the other. And she's having to bat it away, right?
Yes.
Endlessly and say, no, sorry, this is what I've carved for myself. Thank you for your perception and perspective. I continue to carve this space for myself and own it and claim it because it is my own. Thank you very much.
And it is hard. And I think it's for people who are skating multiple cultures and races, it's a very difficult place because you never solely belong to one. So you never yes. see yourself reflected clearly or with any strength in one. So you're constantly having to juggle and battle exactly what you're talking about. Mm. And then when you get into communities where there are multiple essences and identities within that, so Judaism is one of those, where there are fluctuations and cultural spectrums within that, it also becomes further complicated.
Yeah. Mm.
So that within the Jewish community, there are going to be levels of acceptance
yeah.
within what that means to be Jewish.
Yeah.
So then you have those sorts of levels that you're dealing with on top of
yes.
a multiracial identity.
Yes.
So it does become hard. It does become complicated. But someone like Cameron, I feel, has worked out a way
yeah.
to publicly claim.
Publicly.
And,
yeah.
and I think it's beautiful.
Yeah.
She does it with song. She does it with humor. She yeah. does it with intelligence.
Yeah. So Noi gracefully shared one of her Instagram videos with me, right, where I saw her singing. And I could see the generosity and the gracefulness and the humor with which she deals with this, right? I really, really thought it was very, very elegant. Really, really like her very much.
Yeah, I saw the strength in someone like her, kind of the wisdom, regardless of age, putting those very different and very special elements together in her life, in her own terms. And I just had such an appreciation for that, even though I must confess, I'm still digesting how a person can hold so much richness of content of one's culture and make it digestible. Like I'm still
And do it publicly.
Right. I'm still like awestruck and a little bit like,
she's amazing.
I don't quite get all of the content, to be really honest, but it's that deep sense of appreciation that I got from her ability to do so. Mm. And, you know, in that conversation with you, Noi, I now see that in you as well, which I don't think I fully appreciated before. And in some ways it took listening to you have a conversation with someone like you for me to really, really get it. So thanks for your patience with the likes of us who are a bit clueless.
Yeah, a bit clueless, operating from our blind spots.
Yeah.
That was graceful for you too.
I feel like we're such grown-ups now. These interviews are really helping me feel more grown up and matured in the way I understand Australia. I understand the diversity and all of those dynamics. So deeply, deeply grateful.
Thank you. Thanks, Anna. Thanks, Noi. And thanks, Cameron.
Thank you. Thanks for listening to Like Us, an SBS audio podcast. You can find more episodes at sbs.com.au/likeus and follow us in the SBS audio app or wherever you get your podcasts. Your hosts are me, Noi Harsel, Anna Yeon, and Zione Walker-Nthenda. We are produced and engineered by Michael Burrows at Tomato Studios with support from the podcast team at SBS Audio.